the Voice America Business Channel. For more information about our network and to check our additional show hosts and topics of interest, please visit voiceamericabusiness.com. The Voice America Talk Radio Network is the worldwide leader in live internet talk radio. Visit voiceamerica.com. The views and ideas expressed on the following program are strictly those of the host or guests and do not necessarily reflect the views and ideas held by the Voice America Talk Radio Network, its staff, and management.
Like a chrysalis, we're emerging from the economy of the Industrial Revolution. An economy confined to and limited by the Earth's physical resources into the economy in mind, in which there are no bounds on human imagination, and the freedom to create is the most precious natural resource.
Welcome to the Soul of Enterprise, Business in the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, energizing the success of businesses and communities throughout the world through the imagination of our people and smart technology. I'm at class with my friend and co-host Ron Baker, and on today's show, we will be interviewing Colonel Richard A. Searfoss. Hey, Ron, how are you doing?
I'm great, Ed. How are you?
I'm like... My son, we're going to be talking to an astronaut today, Ron, on the show.
I was telling
my 10-year-old son this, and he's still 10, not a teenager yet, and he thinks I'm like the coolest person in the world to be talking to an astronaut. So,
one of 500 people, Ed, that's been in space.
I know. This is absolutely incredible. Well, let me introduce our guest. Colonel Richard A. Searfoss was born in 1956 in Mount Clemens, Michigan, but considers Portsmouth, New Hampshire to be his home, and he became an Eagle Scout, Ron, and I think that a high percentage of Eagle Scouts are astronauts, so we'll have to ask him about that. But he graduated from Portsmouth Senior High School and then went on to receive a Bachelor of Science in Aeronautical Engineering from the United States Air Force Academy in 1978. Just that alone is pretty incredible and intense. He's a Master of Science with a degree in Aeronautics from the California Institute of Technology. And went on to the Air Force. He attended the Squadron Officer School, Air Command and Staff College, and the Air War College. Then, after all that, Ron... He went on to become an astronaut in 1991, where he piloted space shuttles STS-58 and 76 and commanded space shuttle STS-90, which was famous for the Noro Lab, so we'll get into that later on with him. And then, which is the place I'm going to start out this interview after I finally introduce him, he went on to star in a commercial for Volkswagen. So... Welcome to the Soul of Enterprise, Colonel Rick Searfoss.
Oh, thanks, Ed.
So I'm going to ask first. So tell me about being in a commercial with a car.
Oh, hey, that was great fun. I'm sitting in the Denver airport one day on the way to a speaking engagement. I get this call on my mobile, and this gal from an advertising agency is saying, hey, you're an astronaut, right? And I go, yeah. And she said, we need you for a commercial. Are you interested? And I go, yeah, sure. Tell me, when is this? And he goes, next week. Oh, next week, yeah, we'll make it work. And I go, okay, well, we'll get back to you. We have to check with your creatives. Do you have a headshot or anything? I go, no, I'm not an actor. I'm an astronaut. And they go, well, do you have anything on the internet? And I gave her a few resources. She went and checked it out a couple hours later. She said, yeah, you'll do. The creatives say you look enough like an astronaut, so we can do it. And the idea, they just wanted, Volkswagen wanted to compare, you know, technical prowess and engineering between NASA and what they did, and that was the whole setup. But it was fun, I learned a lot. Heidi Klum was on set just before me, because she did one in this series as well, and I was actually very impressed with her personality and sort of a leadership component that she presented, because her handlers were trying to get her out of there in a hurry, but she took the time to visit with everyone on the crew and took pictures with them on the set and just was very gracious to these folks. So that was very impressive from my viewpoint.
That's fantastic. So you argued with the Volkswagen about how many, the number of engineers at NASA versus VW.
Exactly.
I found the commercial, and we'll be sure to post it as part
YouTube,
of our
sure.
Yeah, it's out there on YouTube. So we'll post it as part of our show notes. How long did it take? Just curious.
Oh, it was just, a couple hour shoot, and it's locally here in L.A. It's a couple hour drive for me, so I drove down, did it, and I actually had to leave that afternoon to go on another one of my corporate speaking engagements, so it all worked out great. And, nice little variety. I've also consulted on some movies. I consulted on the Tom Cruise sci-fi flick Oblivion and on Green Lantern. Actually got a cameo appearance in Green Lantern, which was kind of fun. So I've done a variety of different interesting things.
Oh, that's fun. That's fun. Okay, well, now back on. And I should have also mentioned that you're also the author of Liftoff, An Astronaut's Commander's Countdown for Purpose-Powered Leadership, which we will definitely talk to you about. One of the things I want to mention to the audience, if you pick up a copy of this book, do not be thrown off by the fact that the chapters go in reverse order. That's on purpose.
That's plan. It's a countdown.
As planned. Just to throw you off. But first question I wanted to ask you is, okay, so you were the pilot of STSs 58 and 76 and the commander of STS 90. What's the difference between a pilot and a commander?
Right. Well, in the space shuttle program, of course, you had to have very experienced military background test pilots to actually fly and land the vehicle. So I came into the program as a pilot astronaut, hired specifically because of that background. And the career progression, so to speak, is you start out as the pilot in the right seat. You're really a co-pilot, but, we very experienced military test pilots don't want to call ourselves co-pilots, so we call ourselves the pilot. But then after a flight or two, you get the experience and you've progressed well and so forth. Then you get the command responsibility. And the distinction is very clearly on the human side, the leadership side. You're where the buck stops here with the actual execution of the mission and making sure that the crew and the vehicle, this $2 billion national asset comes home safely. So I found a tremendous difference in sort of my mindset and preparation between being the pilot in the right seat, where it was focused solely on the technical performance and just, drilling into my systems and so forth. And as commander, I had all of that for my own technical systems, plus the big picture in mind and being the leader and making sure it all comes together.
But is it the pilot or the commander who lands the vehicle when it comes down to
Earth? It's actually the commander. NASA made it a little bit confusing, but the commander is actually a pilot. It's equivalent to the airline captain, is even sitting in the left seat, but we just delineate the crew positions a little differently. And there's enough redundancy in the systems and the training that if there were, for some reason, if a commander would have ever been incapacitated, the pilot could fly the shuttle and land it from the right seat. But normally the commander would do that task.
That makes sense. So there would be always two people on the shuttle who could theoretically land it.
Kind of summarize the difference is a story I like to tell from up in the middle of my first mission. I was having a great time. The mission was going great, working hard. My commander pulled me aside in the middle one day and goes, Rick, it's going to be different when you're a commander. And I'm going, yeah, okay, John, what do you mean? He goes, you could be having a great mission. It could be an A-plus mission, but it's always going to be in the back of your mind. If you screw up the landing, an A-plus could turn into an F in a heartbeat. And it's always going to be in the back of your mind that at the end of the day, you have to fulfill that properly, no matter how well the mission has gone, or it's not going to be a success. And that it was a great lesson for me. And I actually very much had those feelings when I was up on board, constantly thinking about everything, that it's not over till it's over. When you get to wheel stop and you're home safe and sound, then you can breathe a sigh of relief. But up to then, you've got to be totally on your game.
That's just incredible to me, the science behind pulling this ship out of orbit at the right window to land it without any power. I mean, you're a glider at that point, right?
Oh yes, it's the world's biggest glider, and in some ways a very poor performing glider. But that's fine. It's poor performing from the point of view that it doesn't go very far forward for how much it goes down. But that's what you want. You want all that drag to take away all the tremendous energy you have from orbital speeds to get back to a landing. And it really was, fascinating for me right from the start when they first developed the shuttle, and then all the way through the decade of the 90s when I was in the program. All of the intricacies involved to make that work, so much of which the general public was just never aware of, but the details of it were fascinating. I mean, we could talk for hours and hours and hours of those technical things, but what in retrospect now, many years after I complete my astronaut duties, in retrospect, what's most amazing to me are the teams and the people that pulled it off that made it look easy when it was anything but easy.
Yeah, I have a favorite word that I like to talk about with regard to that, it's an Italian word, and the word is sprezzatura, and it specifically means the ability to make something that is extraordinarily difficult look easy.
Yeah.
And the example I usually give, but now, I will now give you in the space shuttle as another example. But the example I usually give is like shortstop Derek Jeter, you know, making a diving stop in the hole and then throwing a guy out. You know, then he just kind of kicks the dirt off him
to first base.
Yeah. So that's sprezzatura. So yes, that's a great another good story is that this is the whole space shuttle program is a great example of sprezzatura. I want to ask you just a little bit because we're only like 3 minutes away from break, going by so fast here. But you, one of the things that I noticed in your biography, 6,000 hours of flying in 77 different types of aircraft. So as a test pilot, that's a lot of aircraft.
Yeah, it's not actually up to 84 now. I've got a few new ones in my logbook recently. And that's part and parcel, actually, the training and preparation for test pilots, anyone that goes to military test pilot school, because they need to have the adaptability and an incredible breadth. There's no one with more breadth of experience in aviation than people who are trained as test pilots. And I mean, that's why NASA hires test pilots to be pilot astronauts, you know, because you're used to dealing with a lot of unknown situations and you're prepared for it. And it's great fun too. It's not like I've been totally checked out in all of those different airplanes. Many of them have just been a one or two flight kind of experience, but I've had the chance to go see what their flying qualities are, how they perform, evaluate the airplanes, and it's just been loads of fun.
Was there any one that you got into that you said, this is really not a good idea?
I would say, and primarily the airplanes I flew operationally, where I, you know, flying a lot of flights in these airplanes, like the F-4 Phantom or the F-111 Aardvark I used to fly in the Air Force many moons ago. Yeah, on the proverbial dark and stormy night when you got a bad emergency going on, I had a few of those that, you know, but in the heat of battle, you don't really think of that. You're just kind of like, okay, I got to get us out of this situation, and you just do the stress when the training and the preparation kicks in. And then it's when you get down on the ground, you go, wow, I'm really glad that one worked out okay. I had a few of those.
Well, we will certainly get into some of those stories, but right now we're up against our first break, and we want to remind you that you can get a hold of Ron or myself by emailing us at asktsoe@verisage.com. Please also check out our website at thesoulofenterprise.com, which is where we have all of our show notes as well as previews for upcoming shows. And please do keep those reviews on Amazon of our book, The Soul of Enterprise, and also the podcast on iTunes coming. They mean the world to us, and we really do appreciate that. So thanks for that. But right now we're going to hear from our sponsor, Leading Results.
Become our friend on Facebook. Post your thoughts about our shows and network on our timeline. Visit facebook.com/Voice America.
Is your website just a brochure, or is it your best salesperson? If your site is not the best lead generation tool you have, we should talk. We are Leading Results. We build websites and marketing programs that impact your bottom line. Using HubSpot or WordPress, we'll create a website and supporting marketing program that gets your business found, converts web visitors to leads, and provides clear tracking on what is and is not working. Learn about our team and approach to your success. Visit leadingresults.com/TSOE to find out more.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. But have you ever read a book where the foreword changed your life? Me neither. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I wrote the foreword to Ron Baker and Ed Kless's new ebook, The Soul of Enterprise, Dialogues on Business and the Knowledge Economy. The value of this book is found entirely in its foreword. So when you buy it, think of it as buying the foreword and getting the rest of the book for free. Available now for download exclusively on Amazon.com.
We're always talking business. Talk to an expert. Call now, toll free, 866-472-5790. That's 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network.
We're tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Well, welcome back, everybody. We're honored to be here with Colonel Rick Searfoss, former astronaut and space shuttle commander. And Rick, I kind of want to get into your book a little bit. You were gracious enough to send Ed and I a copy of it, and I've been reading it the last week, and it's called Liftoff, an astronaut commander's countdown for purpose-powered leadership. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. It's just a great book. I loved all your stories from it.
Well, thank you, Ron. I appreciate that.
I mean, not only your astronaut stories, but I'm just as kind of fascinated by your Air Force career and all the things you did there. But I wanted to ask you, what was your primary motivation for writing the book?
Well, I've been a leadership speaker for the last 10, 12 years, and I love engaging with business audiences and sharing my particular take on leadership from my particular background. And the book is really a culmination of that, or is bringing all of the stories and the experiences together in one place to kind of be the summary of my message when it comes to leadership. I've thoroughly enjoyed the speaking, but this is a way to branch out in another direction with that. And interestingly enough, no other astronaut or former astronaut has ever written a book about leadership, yet it's part and parcel of those, particularly those who command human space missions in such a dynamic and difficult environment, you know, where everything's on the line. And I felt there was a lot that I could share, in particular for business organizations, but really any organization that's trying to go after a difficult, challenging mission.
Right, and you were inspired by Dr. Stephen Covey, weren't you?
Yes, very much so. In a personal way, too. I met him. I was still in the astronaut corps and was giving a presentation at a big patriotic event, and he was there in attendance, heard me speak, and came up to me afterwards in a reception and asked if he could use a quote for one of his new books coming out. I'm incredibly honored, blown away. And we got to chatting, and I indicated that I was about to retire from the Air Force and NASA, and I was kind of concerned about going into the business community because all my academic background is very technical, and you know, I hadn't been in business per se, and he looked at me like I was a little crazy, and he goes, you know, you've got 25 years of leadership and teamwork. That's what American business needs more than anything else. You can figure out how to read a balance sheet. And that was a pivotal point for me. In that time between then and when I actually did retire, I really reframed my view of what I had to offer in the business world, and it was just a wonderful experience for me.
Excellent. I remember you telling me at dinner that most of the astronauts have written, you know, personal memoirs that, you know, how we went to potty in space, but you wanted to do a leadership book.
Yeah, I mean,
book,
there's some of that. It goes, you know, either the memoirs, the very famous, of course, the moonwalkers and so forth had their memoirs, and then the questions, the commonly asked questions about flying in space. There's even a kid's book or two out there about it, which are really fun. I mean, Mark Kelly wrote a wonderful one called Maustronaut that I read to my grandson, and I go, hey, I know this astronaut that wrote this book. He's my friend. And my grandson goes, oh, cool, you know. It's all good.
Well, I won't ask you about it, but you do tell a story in the book about the toilet exploding on one of your flights.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's just sum it up to say that when I, as the commander, had to fix a toilet that had, it was giving us a few issues, I would have loved to delegate that, but the only other person trained on it had another competing priority at the time, which was a higher priority. So I fixed the toilet in space as the commander of the space shuttle, and as I was doing it, I distinctly remember thinking, you know, this job isn't nearly as glamorous as people think it is. But necessary part of the systems, you know, and we got it fixed, so it was fine.
And Rick, how do you distinguish, because I love how you define leadership, but how do you distinguish between management and leadership?
Right. Well, in my view, you know, leadership is simply influencing others for the good. And the focus in my book is really more at the operational level or the execution piece of leadership. I mean, I talk about, because it's a necessary precursor, some of the strategic implications and aspects, but it's really about, you know, rolling your sleeves up on the line and that kind of leadership. And that, of course, is perhaps the other side of the coin, or relates to management, doing, you know, making sure you get the details right. But leadership helps you structure so that you do the right things and you influence the people in a very, you know, soul-centered sort of way. And that's why when I first met you and Ed, I loved your approach to business and the soul of enterprise and the very much intangibles that play into things that I think, by and large, in the last 20 years or so, businesses have often gotten away from. We've gotten so technically oriented, we're so keyed into our dashboards and our metrics and the numbers that we sometimes forget it's not just the numbers.
Right. You know, I love your definition. Leadership simply means influencing others for good. I just love that. I think it's really, really a good way to put it.
Yeah. Well, I tried to take him all my experience, you know, in government settings, military settings, commercial settings, and extracting the common element. And I think that part for good is absolutely crucial. I mean, you have people who lead or have led in history to do some terrible, awful things. I mean, the 20th century is riddled with that. And yet, in my view, that's not real leadership. It's not anything close to the kind of leadership we should aspire to. We need to have a purpose-driven and focus that is towards doing good.
Right. And I want to jump into your model, your 4P leadership performance balance model. But you also say about leadership that you need trust. And I really loved how you emphasized trust. It made me think of that. I think it's a military saying that the soldier is entitled to competent command.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, I talk about the components of trust, and then, of course, we rightfully think of integrity being first in that equation, but it's not the only part of the equation. You know, beyond the integrity and doing the right thing, you need to have the competence to make the right kinds of decisions so that your people can trust you. Otherwise, that trust will erode. And I've been fortunate enough to be in leadership positions where that's just very clear. If you're not hacking it as the commander or in a very demanding sort of position like being an astronaut, it will be very obvious to the world, and there's just no way you're going to have the respect or trust of people who where that's required to do the job as a team.
Right. Well, like you say, everything is on the line, but and in the Air Force too.
Very much so. I mean, the culture with and generally the culture's not totally, the subtleties of the culture is not really appreciated, I think, by and large in the civilian world, of the elite military units, like, you know, your special forces units, of course, and military fighter squadrons or flight test squadrons, where it's extremely demanding and competitive to get in, and very, very high standards. And the subtleties of the culture are that even with all that and the competitiveness of it all, at the end of the day, it's all about being there for your buddy and backing them up, never leaving anyone behind. Of course, a SEAL, important part of the SEAL credo, and in the fighter squadron is just be always there for your wingman. And for me, that was just the absolute best part of being in those units, the intangible sense of being able to trust someone with your lives and being part of something that's so much greater than yourself. You know, money can't buy that. And
right.
I look back on my life and my professional experiences, and I treasure every single one of those.
Rick, in the book, you lay out a 4P leadership performance balance model, purpose, people, perspective, and program, and you lay out 12 key principles. We're not going to have time to go through them all, but can you talk about, because I just love how you start with purpose.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's coming again from a military background, it's all about the mission. You know, what are we set tasked to do today? What does our nation need us to do, either in this combat situation or humanitarian situations or just day-to-day training? What's the mission? And that evolves to purpose. And, of course, I set up my 4 P's to be something easy to remember, and the 4P aspect of it helps with that. But purpose, you know, what are we really all about? What are we driving towards? Let's not just spin our wheels. And there are components of that that I think set you on the right path or get you out to the launch pad. You know, choosing to do difficult things, I believe, informs a sense of purpose. searching for a mission that really matters, that provides service to others, that even obviously as a business, you're in business to make a profit and to survive and grow the business. But along the way, you do that by bringing value to your customers. And that's a mission that really matters, is serving others. And the other component of it, I think it's important, that lights the fire to get off the launch pad, you might say, is having a deep abiding love of what you're doing, or passion is sometimes an overused term in that context, but because it can be a still waters run deep kind of commitment to what you're doing. But all of those rolled together gives an organization or an individual a focus and a purpose that is very, very powerful in setting the stage for everything to follow.
Well, you know, I love how you say don't mistake activity for progress, because all airspeed no direction just gets you lost.
That's concept is presented in a lot of business writing, but I present it with an aviation twist.
Yes.
That, you know, all airspeed with no direction gets you lost in a real hurry.
You know, your 12th principle, I absolutely love too. It's choose the hard. Mm-hmm. And you talk about JFK when he issued his challenge to land on the moon and come back safely. I don't want to leave that part out. That's important. But I didn't realize this, Rick, but our experience at that point in time with spaceflight was 4 flights, 6 orbits, and barely 10 people hours in space when JFK issued that challenge.
Yeah, I mean, we were just barely in the infancy of humans going into space, and to lay out that challenge there to our nation was just phenomenal. And I think speaks very, very well of President Kennedy's long-term vision and understanding of the importance of that. And he laid out in that same speech, with the help of a great speechwriter, you know, some great metaphors about setting sail across uncharted new seas and so forth, and how we would accomplish so much more by setting this bar high than if we just continued to muddle along. And, you know, I learned firsthand, once I got into the program, how difficult space flight really is, human space flight. I mean, even as a kid, I'd wanted to be an astronaut. It was always my dream. And I'd gone through some difficult things before in my military training, but getting ready for my first shuttle mission was the hardest thing I ever did professionally. I mean, just it seemed like the work never ended. And I just had to keep reminding myself, hey, you want to do this. You're choosing to do this hard thing, and there will be benefits which come from it. And I found benefits from an individual point of view and also from an organizational point of view are just phenomenal if you take that philosophy on board.
Right. The link there, I think, with business is terrific, because, I mean, what worth having is easy, you know, mm-hmm. and all profits come from risk.
Exactly.
And that's what I really appreciated about your book, about, you know, that principle, choose the hard. I thought that was an excellent metaphor. You know, the other thing I wanted to ask you about, I know we're kind of running up against a break here, but Ed and I think the after action review is the best learning tool ever created. It's just amazing. And you say in the book that the AAR, I think you call it a debriefing after shuttle.
The AAR, from its military heritage, typically came from the Army, and although it's the same thing in an Air Force or an aviation context, we always just call it the debriefing, but same thing.
Right, yeah. Right. You say the flight's not over until after the debriefing.
Exactly.
And you did a 2-week debriefing after the space shuttle flight.
Yes, every day. I mean, 8 or 10 hours a day, every single system, going through over the timeline with a fine-tooth comb, what we could have done better, capture all those lessons, pass them forward throughout not just the flight crew and within the astronaut office, but every part of the operational and the payload structure of the program. And, you know, it's absolutely crucial. In fact, a little bit of a comical metaphor that ties into this that you might appreciate. What's the difference between fighter pilots and apes? And there are many differences and many similarities, too. But one of the key differences is apes almost never debrief one another.
Debrief. And I do remember reading that.
You know, everything you do, from the simplest little two-ship formation flight where you do some basic building block kind of training, all the way up to a huge integrated exercise with hundreds of airplanes or a combat operation, you know, Desert Storm or all of the activities since, you always come down back afterwards and you pick it apart. When I was going through the U.S. Air Force Fighter Weapons School, which is sort of an elite, think of a PhD level in fighter tactics and so forth, we would prepare for a mission. A two-hour flight would take us about 5 or 6 hours to prepare for. Then we'd fly the flight, and we'd come back, and we, as the student instructors, so to speak, would conduct a debrief that would last about 3 hours, and then our instructors would go after us from start from square one and do another three-hour debrief. It just It seemed like all we were doing was debriefing, but you extract so many lessons when you have enough diligence to do that. And it's, of all the things I've seen in business crossing over from best practices and so forth from NASA and the military, the one I find gets typically the short shrift is the after-action review or the debriefing. And I would suspect you and Ed feel the same way, that there's just not enough of it done in business because everyone's off to the next best thing, and time is money. We can't waste time talking about what we did. But it's crucial. Yep.
It is crucial. Well, Rick, this is great, but we're up against a break. And folks, I'd like to remind you, if you'd like to contact Ed or myself, you can do so at asktsoe@verisage.com. But now we want to hear from our sponsor, Azamba.
We're making it easier to listen to the Voice America Talk Radio Network live wherever you go on iPhone, BlackBerry, or Android. Download it from the Apple iTunes App Store, BlackBerry App World, or Android Market.
We believe great companies can become even greater by challenging the status quo within their companies. The latest challenge to your status quo? The way people buy has changed. Buyers now control the majority of the front end of the sales process. Sellers must learn to facilitate a buying process, not conduct a sales process. Social buying signals are an opportunity for sales. Learn more. Go to quantacrm.com/ABC to request a copy of the white paper, Always Be Closing, a guide to the new art of social selling.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. But have you ever read a book where the foreword changed your life? Me neither. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I wrote the foreword to Ron Baker and Ed Kless's new ebook, The Solemn Enterprise, Dialogues on Business and the Knowledge Economy. The value of this book is found entirely in its foreword. So when you buy it, think of it as buying the foreword and getting the rest of the book for free. Available now for download exclusively on Amazon.com.
The business community's first choice in Internet Talk Radio, Voice America Business Network.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are back on The Soul of Enterprise with Colonel Rick Searfoss, astronaut and space shuttle commander, and also author of Liftoff, An Astronaut Commander's Countdown for Purpose-Powered Leadership. I wanted to drill in on the mission where you were the commander, and that is STS Space Shuttle 90 Neurolab, where a tremendous number of experiments were conducted in neurobiology. It's also, you mentioned during the break, the fourth longest ever space shuttle mission. So tell us a little bit about that mission.
Yeah, well, so this mission was actually 8 years in the preparation and development. The idea was at the beginning of the 90s for NASA to do a contribution to the decade of the brain. Many of us don't realize that the 90s was the decade of the brain. But NASA partnered with the National Institutes of Health, so it wasn't just a NASA mission. And they got leading-edge neuroscientists from around the world, NIH and universities and so forth, to pull together the best experiments they could find that could take advantage of this unique environment of microgravity. And, you know, every physiological function of plants, animals, humans changes when you take gravity away. And the whole idea was, in this unique environment, to pull out the results we could and data that tied into neuroscience. So, you know, that's not my field technically. My field's in engineering, physics, and flight test. And that's what's needed to command the mission and to fly the shuttle and so forth. But I had the amazing privilege of working with some super smart docs, not just in the flight crew, but our principal investigators and the NASA support people. And it was a real joy for me to broaden my professional horizons to help facilitate, you might say, or make possible them doing this leading-edge, world-class science in this difficult, dynamic environment of space. So great experience from start to finish for me.
And didn't you get to volunteer as a test subject as well?
I did. And, you know, primarily my duties as commander were like overall in charge of the flow of the mission, getting the job done and so forth, and the safety aspects and operating the shuttle. But that still left a little bit of a time in our 16-hour workday every day to participate as a test subject and so forth. And I had some poking and prodding doing. Some of the more invasive experiments they could not do on the pilot or commander just from NASA safety protocols. You know, there was one experiment rig which, you know, you're really constrained in this thing, and they actually poked a wire into the vagus nerve in the leg to measure signals, and they would not let the pilot or commander get poked in the leg nerves during flight. Darn that luck. But I felt it was important from a leadership viewpoint to volunteer to do pre-flight and post-flight data on that, and the scientists were ecstatic. They go, hey, if you would volunteer to do that, that will help us. And I said, sure. And my whole motivation, I mean, that was a little bit uncomfortable, but it wasn't terrible, but my whole motivation was to show these folks that I'm not just the rocket jockey astronaut kind of guy, that I really cared about their results and getting as much as we could towards the purpose of the mission. And it paid tremendous dividends, I felt, in building the team and you know, showing that we're all in it together, and it was a valuable thing to do.
So now I'm going to get to ask a question that I didn't get a chance to ask you. We met you at an ITA event, and I did ask you how does space smell, and I didn't realize that you had not been, I hadn't read your book at the time, that you had not been out. But now I want to ask you, how well do you sleep in space?
Sleeping in space. For each of my three missions, for the first couple nights, I did not sleep particularly well because I'm still getting used to the environment, especially my rookie flight. And you're very keyed up, too. You know, I mean, you're up there, and I got work to do, and I don't want to get behind the timeline, you know, and your mind's just racing. So there's some psychosocial things going on, and there's also just being in this new environment. I had a mild backache going on for the first few days as the fluid shifts physiologically in my body are going on and getting used to that. I never felt queasy or stomach upset or anything. I was fortunate never to have space sickness, so I was good on that. But after a couple days, once that I kind of got used to the environment more and things settled down, and the fatigue, the longer-term fatigue starts setting in, because you're charging, you're hammering it for 16 hours a day. And after a few days, man, I began to sleep like a baby all the way to the end of the mission, and I had no problem. In fact, you want to know how you can rock yourself to sleep in space? in the shuttle, we had these, they're kind of hammock kind of arrangements. They call them sleeping bags, but really like a hammock setup. And so you clip it up in the flight deck, and then you get in it, and you can just kind of, you know, just get yourself moving just a little bit, and then it will pick up and it'll just sway you back up and down for, seems like forever, and almost rock yourself to sleep that way.
Wow. Well, thank you. That's a fantastic story. I want to move on now and talk to you a little bit about what you're doing now. So you left NASA, sure. And then you served as a judge for the Ansari X Prize. And then you've gone on and are working with X-Corps Aerospace in the development of their rocket-powered aircraft. So I take it then that you are very much in favor of civilians in space and branching out beyond just NASA then.
Yeah, I am very much in favor of commercial space activities, been quite involved with that. In fact, you know, when I first left NASA, I've done a variety of things. I did something we call in the Astronaut Corps. When you leave the Astronaut Corps and you go into either NASA or aerospace company management, we call it descending into management. You know, so I did some of that for a while. I had a chance to go back to a test flying position with NASA. Did that for a few years. As that flight test research work was kind of on the wane and not much going on, I found an opportunity to go out in business for myself as an independent consultant and speaker. So I speak to audiences around the country, actually around the world. I've been to China and Australia and Europe several times, Saudi Arabia speaking, about leadership, teamwork, innovation. But then that doesn't fill up all of my time, and I like to stay busy, and I like to stay connected to my technical roots. So I have been consulting with several new space companies through the years on human space flight related things, and in particular, X-Corps Aerospace. I've test flown rocket-powered testbed aircraft, helped in cockpit design of the vehicle they're designing and hope to fly to suborbital space. The X-Prize, kind of a hallmark of innovation. The original XPRIZE was won in 2004, and it's since expanded to many different elements or different industries other than human spaceflight. I was very involved with that as the chief judge. Like I talked about before, I consulted on a few movies. And so very, very eclectic, but my core these days is sharing my leadership and teamwork message as a speaker.
And so who do you think is going to make it to Mars first, NASA or one of these commercial?
Interesting question, and I'm just fascinated by what's going on there. I would not bet against Elon Musk, let's put it that way. I mean, he stood up, SpaceX started this company, a lot of the old sort of dinosaur perspective aerospace people said, I'll never be able to do that, no. And sure enough, they've had great success with their Falcon series of rockets, and they've built NASA contracts based on that success. And he has made it an avowed, publicly stated goal that they're going to Mars. And I think we'll see partnerships between folks like him, very visionary, that also have the resources to commit to developing the technology. We'll see the partnerships between them and the government. And I think when humans eventually go to Mars, it will be in some sort of not only government-private partnership, but also various different governments, very international. So that's coming along. The progress that has happened in the commercial sector of space in the last 10 years have been phenomenal. It's a very, very exciting field to be in now. I see great new creative, innovative things happening, and it's fun to be part of, actually.
Is it just because the private sector can try so many different things as opposed to, you know, governments have a tendency to, hey, this is where it's worked before, and get kind of locked into one way?
I mean, there's a variety of organizational components to it. I have found from working in the private sector too, I mean, it's not all roses out there. The challenges they face in the private sector, you know, funding, of course, is always there for these ventures, and not having enough resources to bear on a problem. Or, you know, the Apollo program, when it came straight down from the president with full support of both houses of Congress, bam, we're going to do this. It was very resource unconstrained. We spent about 6% of the federal budget on the Apollo program during its heyday, whereas currently NASA gets about 0.75%, so, you know, a factor of almost 10 less. In the government, you've got, you know, slower processes and constraints, and the political overlay of Congressman X won't support it because he doesn't have NASA doesn't have a presence in his district, or those kinds of considerations. Those things always frustrated me. But I realize in the private sector, you've got your own challenges and constraints and hurdles you have to hop over. You just deal with them as they come. You focus on your vision and purpose, and you try and make it happen, as opposed to just sitting back and shrugging your shoulders and saying, well, I'll let other people do great things, you know.
All right. Well, hey, listen, great stuff, and we're up against our last break already, so we want to, and I want to let Ron get in here for the last little bit, but I want to remind our audience that you can get a hold of us at asktsoe@verisage.com, and of course, the website, The Soul of Enterprise. Please keep those reviews coming on Amazon as well as on iTunes. We love hearing from you as well, and right now, we're going to hear from our sponsor and my employer, Sage.
Follow us on Twitter at VoiceAmericaTRN. Get the lowdown on guests, new shows, and your favorites. That's VoiceAmericaTRN. Four new employees.
A 20% increase in revenue.
Being one of the 9 million women business owners in the U.S.
These are your proudest numbers, your landmarks of growth and success. Sage helps you achieve business milestones with cloud and software solutions that lead to deeper financial insights, believe in your numbers. See what Sage can do for your business. Visit believeinyournumbers.com today.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. But have you ever read a book where the foreword changed your life? Me neither. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I wrote the foreword to Ron Baker and Ed Kless's new ebook, The Soul of Enterprise, Dialogues on Business and the Knowledge Economy. The value of this book is found entirely in its foreword. So when you buy it, think of it as buying the foreword and getting the rest of the book for free. Available now for download exclusively on Amazon.com.
We're always talking business.
Talk to an expert.
Call now. Toll free. 866-472-5790. That's 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Well, welcome back, everybody. We're honored to be here with Colonel Rick Searfoss, and he's the author of Liftoff, which is a fantastic book on leadership that's also got a lot of aviation stories and, of course, astronaut stories. And Rick, I wanted to ask you, you talked about when you landed the space shuttle that you turned off autopilot. And Ed and I are kind of fascinated with driverless cars and, you know, maybe at some point in the future, pilotless airplanes. But there's skeptics out there that say, no, no, you're always going to need a human override. And one of the things one of these skeptics wrote is that almost all the moon landings, I think all of them, were done by turning off the autopilot and the pilot took over. What's your take on that? I mean, do the pilot needs to fly, doesn't he?
Right, right. Well, just in terms of automation with respect to aviation or spacecraft, automation, it plays a very important role. It does things that humans aren't so great at very, very well, like, for example, maintaining an altitude within just a couple feet for hours on end without getting bored and distracted. But anything that requires the judgment or the adaptability or the flexibility absolutely need humans in the loop. And the other component that ties into it, which is actually a problem these days in aviation with so much reliance on automation and the pilots sometimes losing a bit of their edge on the manual flying skills, when they need them on that proverbial dark and stormy night, they might not be as sharp as they need to be. So there's a lot of give and take back and forth on that. With respect to the space shuttle, it actually had an auto land system. It was never used for a real landing. One flight took it, kept it on auto all the way down to short final to test that system out. But interestingly enough, and you have to keep in mind, too, this was 70s technology when it was designed, and it was also designed to minimize the touchdown sink rate as opposed to precise touchdown speed. So it was the autopilot on the shuttle actually targeted something that wasn't as important. As we began developing the operations, we realized it was much more important within the actual touchdown limits to get to a precise touchdown speed, because you had too slow and you could scrape the tail, too fast and you could exceed the tire limits, and you know, there's a lot of good reasons to have the human landing it, because our performance on that, as demonstrated by thousands of shuttle landing approaches in the Gulfstream 2 trainer we flew, is that the humans were much, much better than the automation with that. The other component is, if you're on an automated system and you've got a couple seconds of getting into the loop if something goes wrong and you have to take over from the system. We've all seen that with our cruise control on the car. You know, you're just cruising along fat, dumb, and happy, and, you know, a chicken runs across the road or something. You've got to get into it, and it takes a couple seconds to adapt. So you're better off to be in the loop earlier, be warmed up, be staying on top of things, than to jump in into the fray. And all of those considerations and more play into the driverless car technology, and it's fascinating to me the great progress they've made. But those that just with their rose-colored glasses stand up and say, "Oh, it's all solved, and there's not going to be any problems," I just, as a technical guy and as a test pilot, I go, "Baloney! There's a lot of problems that have to be solved before this can be operational."
So you're always going to need that big red button for the human override.
Well, yeah, you need to at least have you have to consider all those elements and get to the point You know, I think to the point when, you know, the engineers say a system like that is ready, it means, you know, you have a whole lot more tests to do. That's mm-hmm. been my experience as a test pilot for any sort of system or new development.
Right, right. No, that makes complete sense. You know, in the book, you talk a lot about the views from space and all of that. And I don't want to discount any of that, but I want to ask you about a different scene in the book that you paint. And I thought it was very poignant. I think it was when you were the commander and you're going out to the launch site and you're looking up at the shuttle and you paused for 4 or 5 minutes to...
Yeah.
kind of take in the immensity of this mission, this whole purpose, like you say, that we're about. What was it? I mean, I know you had done 2 missions before as a pilot, and that must have been something, but what was it like to experience that moment as the commander, yeah. that you're in charge of these seven
right.
or eight
well,
other
first
astronauts?
First of all, I must say, we did. We purposefully took about 4 or 5 minutes, and this is in a very, you know, by-the-minute timeline to step outside the Astrovan, look up at the vehicle, and just absorb, do some intangible, just some thinking, maybe even soul-searching, and, you know, like the incredible import of what we're about to do. And as commander, I felt that was very important. My first commander had done that with us. It was hugely beneficial to me. So I had it built into our timeline. And I was mostly cognizant as the commander at that point. This is about the opportunity for my 5 rookies out of 7 of us on the crew to drink this in, to enjoy the enormity of standing by a fully fueled up rocket ship that they're going to ride on into space in a couple hours with all of the support structure pulled back, and it's there in all its glory. It seems like it's a sleeping dragon. And that it's an intangible sort of component that would never show up in the technical list of things that need to get done before you can launch. But on the human side of the equation, it was worth doing, and it was important that we added it in. So it's to this date one of my most treasured memories of being in the program.
Wow. You know, you also wrote about how once the wives got to go up there and kind of be on the bridge that takes the astronauts into the shuttle, and she left right. you a note, I think. Ha ha,
yeah.
I was here
well,
first.
In fact, well, that's another thing that points out organizationally. During my first launch, when I was a rookie, my wife and the wife of one of the other rookies were going out to the launch pad with one of the astronaut escorts. And they got up to the base of the pad, and this escort, he was fairly new and didn't have much experience at Kennedy Space Center with the rules and procedures. And one of the workers said, "Hey, why don't you take him up to the 195-foot level?" And he goes, "Are you sure? Is that okay?" He says, "Yeah, don't worry about it. There's not much going on." So he took him up there, and the wives had open-toed sandals on, and that's a safety violation and those kinds of things. And they were just blown away, also with the immensity of it all, and they were also encouraged, though, because keep in mind, in a couple days from now, their spouses were going to do something really risky. They might, you know, they might die. And sure. It gave them a great comfort, good feeling, and they got back. Of course, the astronaut got in a little bit of trouble from the safety viewpoint, but then he told the boss, he says, "This is a really good thing. If we do this right, and with all the safety procedures, we ought to make this a procedure for every shuttle launch." And after that, they did. And it was, again, another little intangible, human-related thing that ties into the overall success or sense of binding within the organization. And you know, my wife just loved the experience. Again, a treasured memory for her.
Sometimes rocket science isn't science.
That's
it's
right.
Human.
I mean, it's still humans doing this rocket science.
You know, one thing that also really intrigued me, Rick, because of your Air Force history, you flew for the Air Force in the early 80s. So during, you know, the Cold War and kind of in the intense period of the Cold War, too, towards the end. And then when you were pilot of Atlantis, you joined up with the space station Mir,
right.
where the Russians were. That must have just been really interesting to go from them being enemies to now you're working in space together.
Beyond interesting. I mean, it was profoundly amazing to me. I mean, pinching myself kind of. I can't believe I'm on board a Russian space station. I've become friends with Yuri Yusachev and Yuri Onofrenko. And Yuri Onofrenko had been a Soviet Forces Far East fighter pilot when our commander, Kevin Chilton, had been an F-15 pilot in Okinawa. At that same time, in the early 80s, I was an F-111 attack pilot in England, and their backup commander had been a MiG-23 Flogger pilot in Soviet forces East Germany. And here we're 12 years later, we're all trying to do something together in our respective space programs and becoming personal friends, and I got to know them on a personal level. And in fact, I just saw Yuri Yusachev a couple years ago at a space event over in Germany, and we started talking, and it was interesting to me. I reflect now, we didn't talk about really anything technical or even about our time together on Mir. First thing he came up to me, he says, "Rick, I'm going to be a grandpa." I said, "Oh, Yuri, that's great. I've been a grandfather 2 years. It's the best thing ever." And two space guys from different parts of the world who had been, you know, former enemies and then tried to partner and work together, when they, as friends, get together several years later, what do they talk about? They talk about family and people things. And that was just a wonderful experience for me.
Wow, that's all. Well, Rick, this has just been so great. We thank you so much for coming on the show. And folks, we will post full show notes and all the different websites where you can find out more about Colonel Rick Searfoss and his book, Liftoff, An Astronaut Commander's Countdown for Purpose-Powered Leadership. Highly recommended to you for just some great stories and just some wonderful leadership lessons. And Ed, what do we have up for next week?
Next week, Ron, we're going to do one of our episodes where we're going to profile four business books, two each.
Oh, excellent. Well, I look forward to that, and I'll see you in 167 hours.
This has been The Soul of Enterprise, Business in the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, energizing the success of businesses and communities around the world through the imagination of our people and smart technology. Join us next week on Friday at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific. In the meantime, please visit us at www.thesoulofenterprise.com. And again, our special thanks to Colonel Rick Searfoss for being a fantastic guest.